Now let us consider the intellectual virtue, wisdom. This is the virtue of the scientific or theoretical part of the soul, the part of the soul that's concerned with invariable things, as Aristotle calls them, right? These truths that don't change, like the truths of mathematics or the truths of the laws of physics, things like that. So we consider those truths, I should say, using our scientific or theoretical part of the soul. And the virtue of that part of the soul is wisdom. Now, in book 6 of the Nicomachean Ethics, Aristotle does discuss wisdom, but he doesn't really go into detail about what exactly it is. And that's why I had us read the first two chapters of a different work he wrote called The Metaphysics. Because in the first two chapters of The Metaphysics, Aristotle describes in far greater detail what exactly wisdom is. And indeed, the rest of the work, The Metaphysics, is in some way or another an attempt to clarify in even greater detail what exactly wisdom is. But we're not going to get into that. And so from Aristotle's account of wisdom, for that virtue of the scientific or theoretical part of the soul, we're not going to really pay attention to what he says in the Nicomachean Ethics because it's not particularly helpful. We're going to look at what he says in the Metaphysics, where he gives his account of wisdom, right? So this is the virtue of the scientific theoretical part of the soul. All right. In Metaphysics, Book 1, Chapters 1 to 2, Aristotle does two things. He tells us two things about wisdom. First, he clarifies what kind of thing wisdom is. What kind of thing? Well, it's a virtue, but more specifically, it's a kind of knowledge. Wisdom is a kind of knowledge. It's a kind of grasp of the truth of things. Right? That's what he says in the first place. But there are lots of kinds of knowledge. And so he's going to have to get more specific. But before we kind of differentiate wisdom from, say, physics, which is also a kind of knowledge, a brief word about what exactly knowledge is, according to Aristotle. Because Aristotle uses knowledge in a very kind of specific technical way. For Aristotle, not just wisdom, but any kind of knowledge, so knowledge of physics, knowledge of math, wisdom, is going to be knowledge of what he calls explanations or causes or principles. So, to illustrate, in English, it's perfectly normal to say, you know, I look outside and I, oh yeah, the grass is green. I know that the grass out there is green, right? I know that. I'm using the word know, like knowledge. I have knowledge of the greenness of that grass out there. That's a perfectly sensible and reasonable thing to say. Aristotle is using knowledge in a more restricted sense than that. And Aristotle, the way Aristotle uses knowledge, he would say that I do not, in fact, have knowledge of that grass. Because knowledge is fundamentally of causes or explanations or principles. And Aristotle, so what Aristotle would say is that I have a true belief that the grass is green. That's fine. And I have that. But to really have knowledge of grass or of the greenness of grass or however exactly you want to put it, that requires being able to explain why the grass is green, to explain why it works and behaves in the way that it does, right? And something like that, that's not had by just any old random person such as myself. That requires a kind of specialized learning. Right? It's the botanist who has knowledge of grass in that sense, right? Who knows why the grass is green, who knows why they could give you an explanation for why it's shaped the way it is, for why it, whatever, it does what it does during the winter and so on, right? They would be able to cite the causes of these various things that we see about the grass. They'd be able to explain why the grass appears to us in the way that it does, why it does what it does, right? That's the person who has knowledge, the botanist, not me. That's the way Aristotle is using knowledge here, right? It's restricted to this kind of systematic understanding, this specialized, difficult to acquire, systematic understanding, right? So the people over in the physics department have knowledge of physics. Me, I don't. Do I really know why the pen is dropping? Aristotle would want to say, no, not really, because I can't cite the ultimate causes, principles, or explanations for why these things work in this way, for why, you know, physical objects behave in the exact manner that they do. Aristotle would say, I don't have knowledge of physics. It's the physicists, the people over in the physics department, they have knowledge of physics. The botanist has knowledge of grass. The frog scientist, I don't know what they're called, has knowledge of frogs, right? Random old people can have true beliefs about it, but that's not knowledge. So Aristotle is using knowledge in a kind of in a more restrictive way than we typically would, right? So he's talking about kind of systematic understandings of things. That's what knowledge is. So wisdom is going to be something like that. It's going to be some sort of systematic understanding, yeah? An understanding that can cite the causes or principles or explanations of things. Okay, well, as I've just been indicating, there are lots of different kinds of knowledge. Physics, frog science, whatever it's called, botany, economics, whatever, I don't know. Lots of different kinds of sciences, right? And they have different causes or principles that they're concerned with, and they're concerned with different phenomena, different things. They're concerned with different aspects or parts of reality. And so what distinguishes wisdoms from, say, physics or biology or whatever it might be? Aristotle's idea and what he wants to say in answer to this question, what distinguishes wisdom from physics or the other sciences or math, whatever it might be, is that wisdom is the most fundamental of the sciences, of the kinds of knowledge. Wisdom is knowledge of first causes or principles or explanations. And what he has in mind here is that it's knowledge of the ultimate fundamental causes of things. And so to kind of illustrate the point, so... One question that I might ask is, I don't know, we'll go with this one. This is what I usually go with. Why am I, Jeff, here right now? Right? What is the cause or explanation of me? And Aristotle would say there can be different kind of more or less fundamental answers that we give to a question like that. And we give these more or less fundamental answers by consulting more or less fundamental sciences. So, for example, why am I here? You might give something like a biological explanation. So you might cite something like the fact 36 years ago, we don't need to think about it too much, but you know, my parents, they did something and now I'm here, yeah? And that would be a kind of biological explanation for why I'm here, for why anybody's anywhere, right? You might say, okay, so that's one kind of explanation. You cite certain causes, right? You go ask a biologist or whoever it might be, and they can tell you all about it. Okay, fine. But no, that's not what I'm interested in, you might think. I want something more fundamental than that, a more fundamental explanation than just a kind of biological one. Well, what do you mean more fundamental? Well, I don't know. A lot of people have this idea that biology could maybe, this is kind of controversial, but a lot of people have this idea that biology could be reduced to physics, that physics is kind of more fundamental than biology. Because biology, yeah, it's about animals and whatever, and plants and living things, but living things are just made up out of atoms. And so it seems like maybe all biological phenomenon, again, this is controversial, could maybe be explained by the laws of physics. Probably not true, but whatever. Some people say something like that, and we'll just go with it for the time being. So, okay, so maybe physics is kind of more fundamental. And so we might consult this more fundamental science for a explanation or cause of me, right? And so we might say, so why am I here? Well, I don't know, because you're just this, you are this collection of quarks and electrons and bosons and leptons. That's all I got. I don't know. There are more fundamental particles than that, but I'm just a collection of all that kind of stuff. That stuff makes me up. And particles interact according to the laws of physics. And so it just so happens that all those reactions and all those particles have been affected in such a way that all these particles are here right now. And so that's why I'm here right now, because of all these particles and the laws of physics and so on. That would be a kind of more fundamental explanation, allegedly, arguably. Right? So physics might be a kind of more, might give you more fundamental explanations than biology. But now somebody might say, no, I want something even more fundamental, more existential, more like, why are there even particles or forces? Like, why is there even anything at all, including me? Why am I even here at all? Not, I don't want you to tell me about my parents. That's gross. I don't want you to tell me about physics. Because why are there even particles? Why is there anything at all? Why am I here at all? Why is there a universe, a cosmos at all? Why do things exist rather than not exist, right? That would be the most fundamental question, right? That's what wisdom is concerned with, according to Aristotle. He calls it the science, in various places, I don't know that it didn't come up in what we read, but it's the science of being. And so what it cites are the ultimate, or what it's concerned with, what wisdom is concerned with, are the ultimate causes or principles or explanations of being, of why there's something rather than nothing, right? Wisdom is the knowledge of these most fundamental causes and explanations. That's what wisdom is, right? And so it's the most fundamental science. According to Aristotle, it's more fundamental than physics, even, because physics just kind of starts with the assumption that there are particles and forces and so on. And then from there, it can tell you what happens when the particles do this or the forces act or whatever, right? But why forces and particles in the first place? Well, now you're into the realm of wisdom. That's what wisdom is, according to the metaphysics, right? Knowledge of first causes, first explanations. So that's the first thing that Aristotle does in these two chapters, that it's of interest to us, right? So first he clarifies what kind of thing wisdom is. What kind of thing is it? Well, it's knowledge of first causes. It's the most fundamental science, yeah? Second, so one thing you might be wondering now is, well, okay, what are those principles? What are the fundamental causes or explanations or principles of things, right? What specifically is wisdom concerned with? Because like physics, right, is concerned with these fundamental particles. That's the object of physics. And then maybe like the forces, like the fundamental forces. There are four of them, I think. Weak, strong, electromagnetic, and gravitational. That's right. There's four, I think. Four fundamental forces, and then I don't even know how many particles. There's some particles. Physics is concerned with those things, and then how they interact and what goes on, blah, 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 blah. Right? Specific properties that all those things might have and exhibit. Well, okay. In biology, right, it's similarly easy. It's concerned with living things and how they live, and okay, fine. Well, what is wisdom concerned with? What are these causes and principles and explanations? Thankfully, he tells us in the metaphysics. Frank, thankfully, he's actually pretty clear about this. According to Aristotle, the first principles, the ultimate causes, the ultimate explanations for things, for being qua being, is the way he puts it, is God or the gods. We're not going to get into Aristotle's theology, Aristotle's views of the divine. He's not an adherent of traditional Greek religion. And so when he talks about God, he's not talking about Zeus or Dionysus or Hermes and Apollo, things like that. That's not what he has in mind. God, he also refers to God in a later thing as this unmoved mover. You may have heard that phrase. That's his, the phrase he uses to describe God. So he's got this very specific notion of God. It's in certain ways very dissimilar from what we would think. God is not a thing you would pray to in Aristotle's view, his notion of God. It's in certain ways, it's more like a philosophical principle. But in any event, we're not going to worry too much about it. He does think that it's God kind of knows everything there is to know. God is, in some sense, good, in some sense, the cause of all things, right? And that's really what he's picking up on here. According to Aristotle, God is the ultimate cause, the ultimate source, the ultimate explanation of being, of why things are, of things. It's the ultimate explanation of things. And so wisdom is going to be concerned with the first, with fundamental causes, and the fundamental cause is God. And so wisdom is kind of like the science of God. And this leads Aristotle to say various things, like wisdom, it's just theology. Wisdom is theology. It's that science, right? There's physics, there's biology, there's theology. Theology is the most fundamental science. It's wisdom. He also calls wisdom first philosophy. Wisdom, the word in Greek is sophia. The word philosophy in Greek is philosophia. Right? Obviously, there's some overlap there, right? What is the philo? It just means kind of, usually it's translated love of, but it's more like a friend of wisdom. Right? And so philosophy is, to be a philosopher is to be a friend of wisdom. To be a philosopher is to have a love of wisdom, right? And so wisdom and philosophy etymologically are related, and Aristotle's picking up on that too. And so he'll often call wisdom first philosophy. It's kind of the most fundamental philosophy, right? First philosophy in that sense. Theology, first philosophy, same thing according to Aristotle. It's wisdom. This is Aristotle's conception of wisdom. This is the virtue of the theoretical scientific part of the soul.